My name is Mark Harris. I'm an archon here in Sacramento, a part of this wonderful fraternity, Sigma Pi Phi, which is holding its Pacific Regional Conference. This is part of our activities associated with the Pacific Regional Conference. We have a wonderful panel. You've been handed by some members of my staff the bios for these panels. This is an amazingly talented panel, and they have quite a few things that they want to say on this subject that I hope you will find interesting. A couple of ground rules before we get started. Number one, if you have questions, we have pins and index cards that are available to you. Can my staff in the back kind of raise your hands? Erica, Chris, everybody. Those wonderful, talented, good-looking folks back there are the ones who have the index cards and pins, and they're going to hand those to you in the event you have a question. Because we're going to move through and we want to be efficient with our time, we're going to ask you to be efficient with your time, writing your questions down and submitting them to us. The staff will then bring those to two persons here at the ends of the dais. We'll Chet and Jamal, please raise your hands. Jamal and Chet, can you guys raise your hands? So my staff, when you collect those cards, if you'll bring them to those two gentlemen, they will then determine which question we can ask in the context of what the panel is discussing. So we're going to have a real, hopefully efficient, tight process for Q&A. I'm here to hear what these experts have to say. I hope you're here for the same reason. We don't want to cut off the interaction with the community. We're honored that you're all here and supporting us in this way, but I really think we would be remiss if we don't give these experts an opportunity to share their perspectives with you as we spend an hour and a half exploring this topic. So with that, let me ask if, just one second, Ms. Tava? Tava Riley of McClatchy High School here in Sacramento, California, would do us the honor of leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Would everybody please rise? Some of y'all haven't said that since elementary school, so I'm just recognizing the obvious here. I want to, again, thank Ms. Riley and also McClatchy High and also her teacher for being kind enough to bring her here and to make sure that she, listen, there's no more special and important a contribution that's made than the contribution that's made by teachers. So I want to make sure that we recognize, let's give her teacher a round of applause. All right, with that, let me turn it over to our mayor. We are blessed here in Sacramento to have a leader who has a tremendous reputation both locally, regionally, as a matter of the state of California, and more, nationally, he has a tremendous reputation. In fact, I think I read something about him possibly being the next baseball commissioner. I don't know. I mean, he gets my vote. If that's a voting position, Mr. Mayor, you get my vote on that one. But we're blessed to have the Honorable Kevin Johnson join us. I've known Mayor Johnson for almost 30 years. I've had the pleasure of watching him grow and develop, of being involved with his charitable organization, his charter school system. My wife was the principal at one of his charter schools. He's a tremendous visionary and a tremendous leader. With that, let me ask if the mayor would say a few words. Mayor Johnson, Archon Kevin Johnson.
Welcome. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yeah.
No. There's always one.
See if you can push that button, Mr. Mayor. And are those hot? Yeah, I think they are.
All right, how about that? Does that help a little bit?
Yeah, that's good.
I want to welcome everyone to Sacramento. I'm really proud to be able to host so many impressive folks in our community over a 3 or 4 day. I'm looking forward to dinner tonight. Let me just say that right now. I'm hungry. I'm looking forward to dinner tonight. I want to thank Mark Harris for his leadership. You got a very impressive group of panelists here. They have a lot to say. Let me just say this. We talk about Oscar and we talk about Trayvon. There's a crisis going on in this country when it comes to black boys. Across the board, epidemic. And if we don't lead the charge and figure out a way to turn around the trajectory of our young black males, especially those that we have influence of, this country is not going to make it to the next level. And it's real. Let me give you one statistic. You guys have heard this statistic many times. If young kids are not reading at grade level, by the time they leave third grade, 80% of those kids will never catch up. Third grade. If you are not reading at grade level by the time you leave third grade, nearly 80% of those kids will never catch up. Here's what's terrifying. In Sacramento, 80% of our kids that are black are not reading at grade level. In Sacramento, and I hate to tell you, other cities around the state and around the country are very similar. You get, at most, you got a third that are black kids that are reading at grade level, especially black boys. We've got to turn that trajectory around for our young people. Matters worse, you've heard this, probation, jail, parole. A third of our black males are being impacted in a real way. Folsom Prison, 30 minutes from here, right outside of Sacramento. There's a direct correlation between kids who can read and kids who end up becoming adults and end up incarcerated. We did a survey at Folsom Prison. 75% of inmates are illiterate that are black. Go back to third grade reading, a direct correlation. Take it a step further. Three states are building prisons based on third grade reading scores. It's an indicator. It's a predictor. It's real. If you don't have the skills to read, how are you going to be meaningfully employed down the road? We're going to have to get creative and innovative, not the kind that we salute. Our folks get creative and innovative in different ways. And what this panel is and what folks are going to talk about here today is some solutions. And I will tell you, those solutions are going to require us to be at the front of this fight. We can't be on the sidelines. We can't expect government to do it by itself. We can't expect some other community. It's time for all of us to get in the game and make a real difference in our community. So I just say thank you for this particular panel. I want to thank everyone for being a part of it. And again, I look forward to having a conversation again tonight. So God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. For those of you who are from outside of Sacramento, you see how fortunate we are to have the leadership of the Honorable Kevin Johnson. He's someone we're very proud of. Local boy makes good. Local boy has become a tremendous man. So we're very proud of you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you. I want to thank a few people before we really get underway. I want to thank first and foremost Archon Dotson Wilson. Dotson Wilson is the parliamentarian of the California Assembly. He is officially known as the Chief Clerk. He's done a tremendous amount of work on behalf of making sure that we could be here in the Capitol, and I'd like to thank him. I want to go through the entire list, if I may, before you applaud. Assemblymember Cheryl Brown of San Bernardino, her staff, Ms. Shannon McKinley, Ms. Alice Huffman. Many of you are familiar with the tremendous leader we have with the California NAACP. Alice Huffman played a great role of support. Mr. Aubrey Stone is here in the audience. Aubrey, can you wave your hand, please? Aubrey is the president of the California Black Chamber of Commerce, another great leader within our Sacramento community and the state. We have two gentlemen, and I mentioned them before, William Jamal Miller, who's the deputy director of the Governor's Office of Health Equity, if you raise your hand, and also Chester McKenzie. Both of these gentlemen are the newest archons among us in Sacramento. They're very young, talented men, one of whom, in Jamal's case, I've known since he was in high school. They're tremendous leaders, and I'm glad they have joined us up front. Mr. Kenneth K.J. Johnston, raise your hand, K.J., if you will. K.J. is the one behind the camera. He has kindly offered his pro bono services to videotape this and to make it available online. Who says we can't support black-owned businesses? Mr. Johnston is living proof of the fact that we can help one another. And then all the different folks in my staff, including Chris and David, who worked on the digital part of this, Erica and Lily, Timman, all of you who've come out and been supportive. I really appreciate the support that you've given. So with all that, let's give all those folks a round of applause. All right, it's showtime, folks. We didn't go too far behind. I want to start with a person who's been a mentor of mine and a friend. I'm going to give very short introductions because, as I said, you have both the paper bios, and you have an opportunity at the end to get the information on where you can access all the information surrounding this panel online. So with that, I would like to ask my dear friend and a leader of our organization, Mr. Robert Harris, if he would get us underway.
Founded in 1904, Sigma Pi Pi Fraternity, also known as the Boule, has 129 member Boules across this nation, with two being outside of the country, in the Bahamas and in London. We're privileged today to be here as members of Sigma Pi Phi. Often you will hear the word archon. Archon simply means that the person is a member of Sigma Pi Phi. We have over 5,000 members throughout the nation. Two of our past grandsire archons are with us today, from New Orleans, Charles Teamer, Oakland, California, Rodney Reed. Finally, let me say this. Men who have achieved both professionally and in their communities, they are actively involved, and for the last 30 to 40 years, been actively involved in social action type programs across this nation, making a difference in the lives of our young black boys. The cases of Trayvon Martin and Oscar Grant. Trayvon Martin was represented by two archons, Errol Park and Benjamin Crump out of Florida. Oscar Grant, his civil lawyers right here with us today, Archon John Burroughs. That gives you somewhat of a flavor of the Boule's involvement in these kinds of issues. So I say thank you for coming out today to be a part of this event sponsored by Sigma Pi Phi Fraternity. I look forward to an exciting afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I would now ask for Attorney Archon James Cole to say a few words, including acknowledging our current grandsire Archon who just entered the room.
Good afternoon. You have heard the term grandsire Archon. The grandsire Archon for our guest is the equivalent of the national president of Sigma Pi Phi Fraternity. I am Grand Sire Archon elect. Robert Harris is past Grand Sire Archon, but we do have a current Grand Sire Archon who is James E. Payne, who's standing in the back. In other words, Archon Harris is the past, I am the future. Archon Payne is the current. As past grandsire Archon Harris just said, social action has long been a primary proponent or component of Sigma Pi Phi Fraternity. We are engaged in social action programs as a means of relating to and giving to the communities in which we reside. We serve through mentoring and scholarship programs, such as the Boule Scholars Program. We have a commission on young black African American males. As I have traveled around the country, I have witnessed member Boules being involved in a variety of community action programs, most of which relate to mentoring young black males and providing scholarships to keep them in school. As was pointed out to those of us who were present in the business section this morning, it is our intent to inspire young African males to want to achieve education and to exceed academically. We realized a long time ago that education will play a key role in solving the problems that we have faced for decades. More than 10 decades ago, Archon W.E.B. Du Bois pointed out that for America in the 20th century, the biggest problem would be the color line. As we look at what happened in the Trayvon Martin case and what happened in the Fruitvale instance, and even what's happening in Washington today, we see evidence of what Archon W.E.B. Du Bois was saying. Most of it relates to the color line. Thank you. I look forward to hearing from our distinguished panel as to additional solutions for the problems we face today.
I've known these two gentlemen for some time. Again, they have exceeded even my expectations of greatness. They are both well described as lawyers. Let me start with asking John Burris to lead us into an exploration of this issue.
Thank you. You know, I have been involved in the criminal justice system and the civil rights area for a long time. And recently when I watched the movie about the grant, Fruitvale, it sort of brought home to me sort of the pathology that exists within the African American community, as well as the challenges that are presented. For those of you who don't know, Oscar Grant was shot and killed on New Year's Day in 2009. He was shot in the back by a local police officer from Bart. And what was important there is that symbolically, the police, before anyone knew what was happening, was attempting to cover it up and to suggest that Oscar himself had contributed. But more importantly, as you watch the movie, you saw the challenges that this young man was facing. And I dare say that what you saw in that movie was very symbolic of what happens every day in America across this country. Because if we witness the number of police shootings that take place, but more importantly, the number of shootings that take place for the black-on-black crimes, which we don't do a lot of talking about, but I will tell you, when Trayvon Martin's case was decided, a nephew from the East Coast called me up and he said to me, "Uncle John, is this going to happen to me?" And I said to him, "No, it's not likely to happen to you. You are more in danger about the African-American community that you live with and the police than you are George Zimmerman." Zimmerman, Mayor Zimmerman, Titus. And so that's the concern that I really have, because what Oscar Grant shows and what Trayvon Martin shows is the very essence of racial profiling. And that we all know what happened in Trayvon Martin in terms of how he was profiled by the clothes he was wearing, the neighborhood he was in, just being walking while black, as we often refer to it, or driving while black, whatever, it was just being black, and certain assumptions were made about him. Those kinds of things happen every day in America. Many of you, are familiar with Stop and Frisk, although we're on the West Coast here, but it was a huge, huge issue in New York City and in Philadelphia, but also in Oakland and other places where African Americans are basically being policed by a police agency that has a state of mind that of an occupying force. And so that's the challenge, because you can be not engaging in any misconduct. If a police officer stops you, if you don't act in a certain way, you could find yourself arrested, in jail, having to fight your way out of this, and you may not have done anything. It's the kind of practice that I have almost every day that I'm dealing with young African American men who may not have done anything but found themselves in contact with the police, and then they have to go to court and fight it out. And often they cannot, and then they get a criminal record. So then you go to the next level, and I think that Michelle Alexander probably does as good a job as anyone in teaching us the ramifications of the criminal justice system by showing that if you get caught up in the criminal justice system with a felony, it is very likely that you are going to lose a number of benefits that would allow you to re-enter into society. And that is disheartening, and we see this almost every day. That also goes to the discriminatory aspect of law enforcement. Those who are involved in the criminal justice system for a while, and it goes to what Mr. James Kohler just said, the problem of race in the 20th century. Well, I'm going to tell you, there's an implicit bias in the criminal justice system, every step along the way. And I have been involved in that process, so I know the challenges that African-American men face. And they make these, they have to face these challenges even if they haven't done anything particularly significant, because their lives can be ruined. And all you have to do to have some real sense of that is look at the enforcement of the drug policies in this country. You all probably have heard about the discriminatory, or the disparity in the enforcement of cocaine, crack cocaine versus powder cocaine. There's a 50 times difference in terms of weight, in terms of crack cocaine versus powder cocaine. That has now changed, and so now it's 18 to 1. But there are countless people, African Americans, who are now in prison, federal and state prison, as a consequence of discriminatory law enforcement and sentencing. More recently, the ACLU published a report that suggests the use of marijuana. We know that marijuana around the country is, there's been more efforts to legitimize it. But now, it is African American is 6 times more likely than a white person to be prosecuted for the use of marijuana. That is startling when whites and blacks use marijuana on the same level. But whites are not prosecuted on the same level. That is a decision that's being made by law enforcement at the point of the stop and the detention. So these are the challenges, because once you get into the criminal justice system, I often refer to it, you are taking a detour away from life in and of itself. Because we all know that we're preparing our kids for these hurdles, first hurdles. You got to have the education. But if you get a criminal conviction, you don't get to that first hurdle. And then you move over into a whole other direction. And so I'm not dealing with those issues. Now, my practice is primarily that of police misconduct. And Oscar Grant was one case that I had that changed the dynamic in many ways, because it allowed the community to involve itself and to challenge law enforcement and public officials for purposes of coming forward and prosecuting that officer. That was rarely done. But it also had the impact of changing police officers and the use of how the tasers were being maintained and handled in terms of, so you don't, quote, make a mistake. These are the kind of things that we work on all the time. But even with all of that, if I look back on some of the successes, I represented 120 African American males in a case where they were being falsely arrested, perjury, and some went to jail. When I talked to those young men as to how far in school did they go, not one person had gone past the 11th grade. Some of them had not even gotten a Social Security card. All of them, the tragedy did not, and I would ask this question, where's your dad? Not one of them had a dad. And so it's pretty clear that the loss of the family structure was at the centerpiece of what had happened to many of these young men. In other cases that I've had, and I represent over 1,000 African-American male and Hispanics and others in police cases, and the vast majority of them do not have a high school diploma. The vast majority of them grew up like weeds, if you will, and had no family structure. I have to say, there have been times when I've gotten money for a family where the person had been killed, that father, who was then dead, was worth more to his children dead than he was alive. That is a sad commentary on the lives that we have. So as I look at this whole process, I understand that, and I think the mayor made the most sense of it all. You really do have to figure out how to get the kids before the third grade. Because when you look and see that the homicide, like in Oakland, we have like of those, about 90% of those African-American boys killing African-American boys. We see what's happening in Chicago and in other places. Well, that is the cancer that exists in our community. Mm-hmm. And we cannot just ignore it, because these individuals, these kids have guns. And, you know, you can talk in very flowery terms about it, but they really are destroying the fabric of our community. And I've seen, when we see young kids being killed, who have been shot accidentally, you know that there's a lack of moral base that exists. Mm-hmm. And somewhere along the way, we really have to address ourselves to that. And I believe that we, as relatively successful people, are in a position to address ourselves to that. But we cannot put blinders on, because I will tell you, many of us who have sons who have also gotten the best of treatment did not follow our particular way. And so we have to somehow get to these individuals and get to these young people and show them that there is a life beyond killing people and stealing and robbing. Because otherwise, we will embark upon a situation where the destruction of the fabric of a vast majority of the African-American community will continue.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, John, for that opening. Let me say a couple of things. One of the roles that I play is on being a faculty member at the University of California, the Merced campus, the newest campus here in California. And Mr. Stone, who's in the audience, asked me to put together, along with my students, a report on some of the problems and issues and challenges, particularly of African Americans in the Central Valley. And one of the things that was shocking, and my mother, who I love and respect so much as an educator for over 50 years, has been very sensitive on education-related issues. I looked at the statistics for academic performance among all groups, every single ethnic group imaginable, English language learners, special needs, you name it. I looked at the numbers. There was only one group of students who underperformed African American students. And I'm not going to do the guessing game with you. I'm going to tell you who they were. Special needs students. That's how bad we are now in terms of these numbers. This is nothing to play with. This is what John just talked about. It's what Jim touched on. It's what the mayor touched on. That's how bad it is now in our schools and with what we're producing in our schools. When we met with the CTA and we tried to challenge them for the positions they've taken protecting teachers over students, they tried to tell us that underperforming was okay because we weren't as underperforming as we used to be. That's, I'm telling you the truth. So that's the dynamic. We keep hearing the same thing. We're going to hear from Mayor Harris, the former mayor of Oakland, and also the chancellor of the Peralta Schools. We're going to hear from this panel. I want to turn it over now, if I may, to John Streeter.
Thank you, Mark. You know, as I sit here, and it is such an honor to do so, next to a dear friend of mine that I've known for 34 years, Mark Harris. And our deep friendship and relationship over the course of all those many years symbolizes something I think that is at the heart of what we're talking about here today. When we were roommates as first-year law students, we looked up to, admired, wanted to be like some lawyers in our local community. Two of them are sitting with us here today, John Burris and Elihu Harris, and we followed and by their example. We stood, we hoped that we would stand on the shoulders of those giants. And as we talk about this topic today, talking about our children, what we need to set ourselves towards is, by way of our example, demonstrating a commitment to the values that led us to be members of this great organization. Let me just say about the issue that we're gathered to talk about here, the specific question that I think Mark is so aptly titled, Saving Our Sons. We remember the history, every one of us in this room, the violence perpetrated towards us as black males, designed to emasculate us, to render us impotent, and above all, to silence us. It was by the whip during slavery. It was by lynching for the next 100 years, and more recently, over the last 50 years, it's most frequently been at the hands of rogue cops and vigilantes. This is a bloody history. We remember it, it resonates. We know that the George Zimmermans of this world, whether they think of themselves this way or not, are the modern heirs to the KKK. That's what we're talking about. But I suggest to you that we will not be silenced. Those of us in a privileged position, in positions of power and influence, the most educated among us have a duty to speak out. God knows our president has disappointed me in many ways over these past few years, but on this issue, he got it right. He spoke out using his bully pulpit. He spoke from the heart, both as the president of the United States and as a husband and a father, as a black man. He told the entire nation what our experience is. Someone who has been touched, who was outraged, as we are, at the killing of Trayvon Martin. We, first of all, in addressing this problem, all of us must find ways to express our moral outrage. Every time an event like this happens, we must do that. And it happens more than we realize. Of course, the Oscar Grant case, which John Burris stepped up and has done such a magnificent job bringing to the attention of the entire country. That, too, is out there. But more recently, there was yet another case in Florida, one less well-known. A young man by the name of Jordan Davis was gunned down in the parking lot. He, too, was a high schooler. He, too, was a young man that lived in a traditional family structure, out with his friends one night, was gunned down by a vigilante white man with a gun. Only a few weeks ago in North Carolina, a young man, a football player from Florida, visiting his girlfriend, was gunned down at the hands of a police officer who we still have yet to learn whether he will be held to account. So these situations are constantly happening around us, and when the mayor reminded us that there is a crisis here, yes, there's the broader crisis, and every one of the member organizations around the country, I know, under the leadership of our Grand Arts, our Archon, is engaging in social action. Rodney Reed has set an example in Oakland, in our chapter, Alpha Gamma, of the importance of doing this, of supporting our young people. That's closely connected to this. But let's not forget the name of the forum here today, Saving Our Sons. What can and should we do to lessen the frequency of these instances in which our young men are gunned down, as Trayvon was? Well, let me offer some suggestions. I think that this ought to be viewed as a collective effort, as I mentioned. Speaking about it, expressing our moral outrages, but the beginning. And quite frankly, I'm looking forward to the discussion here today because I know that many of you here and certainly others on the panel are going to have ideas that I will shamelessly borrow from, as I have from John Burris over the years as a master advocate. But I suggest a couple of things. First of all, I'm a lawyer. I think of things through the prism of the justice system. And one of the things that struck me most about the Trayvon Martin case, and it is, I think, something that runs through every case of this type, is how terribly unfair the process looks from the outside to those of us who are viewing it. And one very simple thing that those of us who work inside the system are acutely aware of is that there is a degree of inherent bias in the jury selection process. The composition of the jury in Florida, which was composed it was a virtually all white jury, had a certain reaction to that situation, and the fundamental problem was that the point of view that any one of us would have brought to the jury table was missing in that jury room. So at a very simple level, there are some things that legislatively perhaps may need to be thought of in ensuring a better fairness in the selection of juries in the criminal justice system.
Now, let me take what John just said, and I'm going to ask Judge Ransom and Mayor Harris particularly to comment on two aspects. Number one, the idea of legislation to change some of these things, personal liability, the process regarding the selection of a jury pool, and if my mother doesn't hit me with her cane, I'm going to tell you all about something that happened to me in the store the other day that talks right about what John is speaking of. It shook me. I was in there, a mother of a kid who couldn't have been older than five, a young black male, was in the store with his mother, and his mother said, and I'm going to quote, "You stupid motherfucker, close your backpack right now." I was shocked. I was absolutely shocked that a mother would talk to their child at that age. And I heard a few of you oopity oop. But I want to tell you the power of this. And as I was moving towards her to chastise her for talking to her child that way, she said, "Don't you know that you will be killed for opening your backpack in the middle of a store? I don't want you to be an accidental death. These people will kill you for that mistake." And I stopped dead in my tracks. I get chills thinking about it, because she was absolutely right. It's just what John said. These folks aren't playing with us when it comes to these guns. And what we need to be telling our kids relative to the reality of that poignant, express word from mother to child is where I want Judge Ransom and Mayor Harris to take us for a few minutes, if they would. Judge Ransom?
Hello there. I've been a judge for some 32 years, and before that I was a criminal defense lawyer. There's very few major cases that came down in the last 30 years that I haven't had a part of. I have signed 500,000 arrest warrants, search warrants, return, at least. Some of these cases end up in federal court. Let me say something briefly about my opinion on the Trayvon Martin case. There were two trials. First was in the public. That was the longest trial. The second was actually in court. I don't know why there wasn't a gag order. Because to me, the whole case was decided well before they got to court. Zimmerman didn't have to testify because he's spoken out in public before. As I said, I've signed a ton of major warrants, and there's hardly any murders in this town I haven't touched on. And I'll tell you something, very few people come forward and say, "I shot somebody, and they're the only witness, and I meant to do it." That didn't happen. That wasn't me, no. He came at me. I was threatened. Well, people don't see that. It's unusual for a person to say, "Well, it's my fault." That's Trayvon Martin. Here's what really concerns me. Not so much today, tomorrow to our youngsters. It was noted earlier today that 47%, only less than 47% of black males in this country graduate high school. Take a secret. You go to New York City, they kill to have 47% because it's much lower, it's closer to 18%. Only 18% of the black boys in New York City graduate. What does that mean? I've always been a realist, I grew up poor. And if the truth be told, when I was the age of all those youngsters, not a person on this planet in their wildest dreams would have seen me as a judge, or even a college graduate, because you didn't live in my part of town, and you didn't have my color skin, and have one teacher tell you you can be somebody. That brings me to a very important point. I do a lot of public speaking. Two things I like to stress. Two things you can give people. One is love, and the second, just as important, is hope. Because I'm going to tell you, I've represented people without hope. You cannot scare a person without hope. The death penalty doesn't scare them. Jails don't scare them. You got to give a person a reason to want to succeed. We must educate our youngsters. Why? Because the reality is, for the generation that's coming up, if you don't have a heck of a job skill, you don't have a college education, you're not going to make it. What's worse? With influx of people coming in with talents, or educated other words, those youngsters who don't have it together are going to be left behind with no way to come forward. Here's my suggestion. Let's go down to third grade and earlier and tell kids why education is important. can be like. Let's be honest with them. I wasn't born with a silver spoon. In fact, when I decided to go to college, it was very unusual for my neighborhood. So my parents said, well, you're the one going to college, you pay for it. So it took me a while to get out. I had every job known to man. The one thing I learned from most of the jobs I had is I don't want to do that as a professional. But we have to make sure, A, our kids learn to read. Make sure they learn to read. And I strongly urge, if you have a child, grandchild, let them learn to speed read. Why? Because most people read about 350 words a minute, which is about what I'm speaking right now, deliberately. They remember half of what they read. Speed reading, you get to 90% percentile. What does that mean? You're going to be an A student. Make sure your youngsters know how to speed read. Now, it's true that you should make a decision by third grade, but we can't give up on that. We can't give up on the people in high school, junior high and high school, because changes can happen, you know. I'll tell you, I'm damn lucky to be here. It's one of the reasons why I still work from time to time. It's always a shock to me that I'm a judge.
Let me take that right. That's a perfect segue. You gotta be careful when you creep up on a judge. There you go. You gotta be careful when you creep up on a judge, because he'll whip that gavel out in a minute. I'm gonna be Judge Grantham, but it's perfectly an appropriate segue now to Mayor, Assembly Member, Chancellor Elihu Harris. He's seen our problems from a number of different vantage points. He's seen them as a six-term assembly member working in this very building, presenting bills in this very room. He's seen them as the mayor of one of the most dynamic cities, and I'm proud to say, in some ways, my adopted city, my adopted home is the city of Oakland. I rep Oakland every chance I get. I'm a proud Sacramentan, but I'm in love with the city of Oakland. I also have seen you as an educator, as chancellor of the Peralta Community College District. You just heard Judge Ransom say, we can't give up on them, even as they move forward. You got a lot of them when they got to the community college, Mr. Chancellor. If you would, if you try to tie those concepts together and share with us your thoughts, we'd appreciate it. Elihu Harris.
First thing I want to say is, Judge Ransom, I'm glad that none of those warrants had my name on it. We heard about accountability, we certainly heard about values, and we heard about the problems of the justice system, and all those things are very real. We heard about accountability. But in the final analysis, you know, here's the reality from my perspective. One, when we have to be more afraid of each other than we are of the police, that's a sad commentary. I didn't grow up scared of black folks. There's some black folks chasing me, I'm running. We have a situation where we've lost our family structures. Churches have become increasingly irrelevant. There is no real sense of value in education. There's no sense of pride and value in our children. So as a people, we're talking about the death of a race. Because nobody going to save us but ourselves. Because other folks don't care. And you think they do, you're very confused. They don't care about each other. You know they don't care about you. So here's what I would suggest. Yeah, community colleges are a wonderful medium for education. Because all you have to do is come. If you don't have money, they give you a tuition and fee waiver. You don't have to pass any admission test. You don't even have to graduate from high school. All you got to do is be 18 years old. And you can go to community college. They are really, truly, the real educational option for anyone who wants an education. And that's why I was really happy to be a community college administrator. But, you know, our values have sunk so low. And we people say, well, you know, you're not with it. Traditional values are no longer relevant. Well, you know, I don't think that's true. You know, when I grew up, I was more scared of my father than the police. If the police called me, I said, please don't call my father. You put me in jail, he'll kill me. You know, and I'm scared of the police. I fear the police. If they stop me, I do Richard Pryor. I'm reaching into my pocket. I'm taking it. My hands are on the wheel. Whatever it takes. But I wasn't afraid of other black people. And when you are, in fact, afraid to be in your own community after dark, maybe in the daytime, and as a mayor, I can go
anywhere in the city of Oakland. I could talk to the drug dealers. I understood what the problem was, certainly the lack of education, but it was also a lack of values. They said, we'll do whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. You don't care if you kill somebody. You don't care if you run over. Didn't make any difference. Because money was the only value that they really saw as relevant. So we can't get back to a sense of we value each other when we want to do good. That means achieve things in life. It's not to help or serve others. It's to help or serve ourselves. Those are bad values, and values that need to be not only decried, but they need to be eliminated. And with accountability, yeah, if somebody is bad, they need to be in jail. I'm like Richard Pryor. Thank God for penitentiary. I know some folks that if they weren't in jail, they'd be here. They'd be worse than terrorists. They're worse than the Taliban. You know. So if we can't begin to talk honestly about our problems, the reality that we've got too many young men who don't value themselves or others, and we've got too many fathers who are in fact having children not only out of wedlock with no responsibility for them, and women who are not selective in their choosing of a mate. Why women have children for no count niggas, I have no understanding. You know, nobody, if a woman is raped, I understand that. When you go to bed with somebody voluntarily who doesn't care about you or the children you produce, boy, talk about a bad choice in life and a bad choice for your children. So we've got to begin to look. This stuff is not complex. You don't need to be a rocket scientist. You don't need to have a community college education to use common sense in approaching these problems. When our churches are only open one day a week, I don't see how that's doing God's work. Church is a seven-day a week institution. When we talk about the reason we have all these problems, it's because we're poor. I tell you this, we've been poor a lot longer than we've been crazy. Mr. Mayor, we said, well, we don't have modern school books. But last time I checked, Dick and Jane were still children, Spot was still a dog. So I don't really want to hear all the excuses. What we need to talk about is the accountability that we expect of each of us, a parent, a child, a teacher, a police officer, a mayor, everybody's got to be accountable for themselves, right, and for the role and responsibility they have, and whatever profession or job they have. Because if we can't do those things, it's all over. Stop fighting and just surrender.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Mr. Mayor, as the moderator, you know, I'm kind of like a lion tamer. I got a chair and a whip. But I got a gun over here, too, so we all have to respect the moderator's decision on time, but I'm glad you didn't in that case because you had so much.
I'm talking shorter than everybody.
I want to do two things, because we do want to have Q&A. We're almost 30 minutes from the end, believe it or not, and I want to make sure we get the audience engaged. There are a couple of things. Judge Ransom asked for me to go back to him. I will. I also want to hear from the young men on the panel. We have two other young men. I don't know if they came in a little late. Adrian Speed, come up please, and Asa Jackson, if you guys would come up. This is not just a bunch of old heads talking. I mean, it's nice to hear what we have to say and think, but these two young men, particularly in Mr. Jackson's case, Mr. Jackson is with the Super Bowl champion Baltimore Ravens and came in specifically to engage with us. Mr. Speed is with the comedian Kevin Hart, Code Black Entertainment. He came in from Los Angeles. So these young men came in from out of town, and I want to make sure we hear what they have to say. Judge Ransom and then Mr. Burris.
When I first started practicing law, which is back in the early 70s, I really thought the major cause of crime was poverty. The major cause of crime today, including most murders, peer pressure. So you've got to get involved so that kids will think before they fall on peer pressure.
That's right.
Peer pressure is our number one problem for crime today. Very few people do things on their own.
Now to the young folks on the panel. Let me ask, if I may, Eric Harris. Eric, as your bio indicated, is a third-year law student at the University of Oregon Law School. If you would, Mr. Harris, would you give us a few of your thoughts to start a little different segment of this panel?
Yes, thanks,
Dan.
Yeah. disability my entire life. I also have four grandparents who all graduated from college. Not very many people in this country can say that they have four grandparents who all graduated from college and two parents who have doctorate degrees. I am in law school, my third year at the University of Oregon School of Law, and I am proud to say that I am an African-American male of privilege. My uncle, godfather, Uncle Elliot was talking about earlier, it's important that we recognize values. All the privileges that I have been great, money privileges, education privileges, but one thing that I can say proudly is that I have been instilled great values by both of my parents, my grandparents, mentors like my Uncle Elliot and others, who have helped guide me through difficulties that I've had in my life all the way through. So, like the mayor was speaking about earlier, education is something very important, and being able to read is something very important. I've been fortunate enough to not necessarily have to deal with many of the issues that other African-American males have to deal with. My mom is an educator. Both of my grandmothers are educators. So I didn't have any excuses, as they say. I'm now in law school. I've spent the last two summers in Washington, D.C. I love politics. I've spent last summer at Attorney John Burris' office working with civil rights cases. I loved working with John Burris. And over these last several years, I've been searching, as everybody my age is, for a job. And I got frustrated this past summer because it's difficult for me to find exactly what I'm looking for. And of course, my father and Uncle Ellie told me, you can't exactly find specifically what you're looking for this early. You're still young, you have time. And, you know, I understand that, but looking up to both of these mentors of mine, I saw that they did whatever they wanted to do. They didn't follow the path that was laid out to them by others. They didn't necessarily go the route that every other attorney goes. I'm getting frustrated with my law school because my school only promotes going from law school to a law firm. And my whole thing has been, I don't know if I want to do that. I love the law. I love other things too. I love policy. I love education. I love public service. And I love sports. And I love disability advocacy, etc. So now that, you know, I am here today, I want to briefly tell you guys about my experience New Year's Eve, the night that Oscar Grant was shot, New Year's Eve of 2009. I was on BART coming back from San Francisco to the East Bay with four of my African-American male friend teammates of mine. So we woke up the next morning, look on the news and say, all this privilege that we have or that Eric has, I wasn't riding a limo back and forth from the East Bay to San Francisco and back. I was on BART, just like a whole lot of other African-American males. And I said, like Dad said earlier, I didn't want to be a mistake. And, you know, speaking with some of these great mentors of mine, I've been able to understand different perspectives. I'm working with my brother and the two gentlemen behind me, mentoring young athletes in the inner city, specifically in Sacramento right now, but kind of branching off from there. And I hope to continue to mentor.
Thank you, sir. John wanted one point, but I want Asa to pick up, because one of the things I've said to Asa in particular, I'm going to put him on Front Street. I told him I was going to do this. Asa is a tremendously talented person. I've known him virtually his whole life. And, you know, I've been old school unk saying, dude, you got to change your appearance. You're giving folks a reason to pick on you. You got all these tattoos, and you got your hair a little different, and you carry yourself a certain way. what happens if somebody makes a mistake? And we had a wonderful conversation the other day, and he said, "Uncle, listen to me. I'll let him say it in his own words, but it was something like this. If I cut my hair and got rid of my tattoos and hid all my piercings, some people still treat me like a nigga. So if thinking that cutting my hair and getting rid of my tats is going to wave the magic wand in terms of how I'm perceived and treated, I'm about that. But since that's not the case, we better come up with some different solutions." And I said, boy, that's some powerful words. So with that, Asa Jackson.
Yeah, no, just like Eric said, I've been fortunate enough to also be brought up in a community, you know, not only my parents, but also having people, you know, like a couple of people that are on this panel right now, that have really shaped the way that I've grown up and I've lived. I haven't had to deal with ever being hungry, with ever walking outside of my house, you know, not feeling safe and feeling that I had to, you know, somehow be prepared for, you know, some kind of tragedy at my house, like some friends that I do have grew up. And one thing that I noticed is that, you know, there was a time when, you know, I didn't have my hair like this, and I didn't have my ears pierced, and I didn't have tattoos. And even then, I still experienced some of the things that everyone has talked about. Still being judged. Still not necessarily getting the same benefit of the doubt, especially dealing with the police, that other people have. And it's unfortunate, but it did shape my opinion to being, well, you know what, it's no matter what I do, I'm always going to be seen first and foremost on my skin. And in 2013, that's not right. And it's hard. It is hard, especially being an athlete, especially being someone that is quote-unquote recognizable. It is hard. You know, being an athlete basically my whole life, I've had to deal with people try to pigeonhole me into what they believe an athlete is, especially being a young African-American male. I mean, since we're all speaking frankly, namely that you're a dumb athlete, you're stupid. You know, there's something that me and a teammate of mine, who's still a great friend of mine, I'll never forget when I went to Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, which does not have a real big African-American population of students. And we, you know, going around, it was our first semester there, or first quarter there, going around and meeting new people. The first thing that they say is, "Oh, so what team do you guys play for?" Okay, granted, we did play football, but for that, I guarantee you, that's not the same question that they asked the other 19,000 students. And it's little stuff like that where, you know, that even though they're correct, you know, we did play sports there, it's more the reason behind it. And it's stereotyping, and it doesn't matter. Like the friend that I'm talking about has no tattoos and has no piercings. And that social side of it, you know, maybe it does make it a little harder. But you know what, for me at least, if someone would just take the time to talk to me and really know who I am, I think my Uncle Mark here can attest that, you know, I'm a pretty well-rounded and a pretty, you know, pretty good young gentleman. And, you know, he's played a big part in that. My dad's here. He's played a big part in that. You know, I've seen a couple other people here. You guys know who you are that played a part in that. And you guys shaped that rather than, you know, my skin color shaping how I'm supposed to act or what I'm supposed to do.
And on Asa's point, I want to go to John because he had a comment. Asa talked about how uncomfortable it is. I'm uncomfortable. I got an uncomfortable feeling when at the Jay-Z concert in Baltimore earlier this summer, somebody asked me, and I was dressed not much different from this, if I could hand them a couple of hot dogs and some soda, mistaking me for the hot dog guy. I'm telling you the truth. This is real. Eric can attest to it. He was there. I was uncomfortable by that. But we're talking about people dying, too. We're talking about a mistake being made about this young man's character leading to his death, to your son's and grandson's character leading to their death. This is not anything we can just accept anymore as a discomfort. It is time for us to take it a heck of a lot more seriously. John Streeter.
First of all, I think that all credit to John Streeter's case, because I do a lot of looking at racial profiling cases, not only in California, but around the country, and it's at the heart of my real concern about policing. But I must admit, we have not had any racial profiling cases out of the CHP in 10, 12 years that I've been focusing on that issue, and that's a tribute to the work that, that they did. It is something that is at the very heart of what we're trying to get at, and that is the racial stereotyping that police officers engage in. And what we're trying to do is develop ways to measure that and gather statistical data. It is surprisingly how challenging it is. Now, certainly after Trayvon Martin's case, Congress had a bill that they were trying to get all police departments to gather this data. That is stop data. You stop with the race of the person, et cetera. What's the basis for it? We also found that the real challenge here is, what does that data mean? How do you analyze that data? And can you get that data back to to the individual person or into some training module? Because ultimately, training is at the issue of it, and then holding people accountable. And so in Oakland, we've been working on this for a very long time with the consent decree. But other departments, I will say that John's point is correct. Departments, for the most part, do want to train their officers better. They don't want to have me suing them all over the place. They really don't want that happening. And I know that's a fact, but they will also cover it up. When I do confront them, they might change it later, which is all good. If you have good defense lawyers on the other side of the table, they will advise them once you talk to them what the proper rule ought to be. So it is an ever-changing process, but progress is being made. Training is important. People on the inside, whether it's the lawyers or the mayors, the city council, can do a whole lot. If they look at these cases from a risk management point of view, you can bring about a lot of changes, and training ultimately is at the forefront, and accountability. I think one point that just goes real closely, officers are not financially accountable. Mm. And so you can sue them all you want, but they're not financially accountable unless it's a punitive damage. And even in those cases, the city pays the money. Mm. So they feel no pain. Mm. There's no pain. I mean, every now and then I'll get an officer to pay $5,000, $10,000, or $50,000, once $100,000. But that's rigged. And so without that pain, this is a legislative type issue. The biggest and toughest lobbyists in the country, of course, are the police lobbyists. And they have gotten laws in place to insulate the police from basically having these kind of obligations.
Let me take that as an opportunity. Mayor Harris, I'm asking you to put on both your legislator's hat as the former chairman of our Assembly Judiciary Committee and your mayor's hat. Is it realistic to think that we're going to have some level of personal liability for officers? Do you think that's something that's legislatively feasible?
No. But let me say this. So, you know, when I was mayor of Oakland, John Burris used to sue the city so often and get so many victories. I wouldn't have a John Burris endowment in the city budget. Because police officers aren't liable, and they're very seldom punished in any way, i.e. demotion or suspension. They, if they care, it's a personal caring. And the only thing that made a difference is training and trying to get officers and administrators in the police department in place who are more sensitive than those that they replace. So I do want to say, no, it's not going to happen in the legislature. Everybody's sympathetic with police officers. They got a tough job. And rather than go after the bad cops, who are in fact the minority, we don't go after any of them. And I don't think that's going to change unless the public decides it's going to change. And it's not going to change long as only victims go back.
I want to start with Martin Harris, ask you to speak, and then I want to hear from Adrian Speed, and then we want to open it up for Q&A. Mr. Martin Harris.
Yes.
All right. The reason why I'm wearing this hoodie, I don't know if a lot of you guys know this, but I'm a student athlete, along with my brother, along with Adrian, along with Acer, and even though that we have the privilege of education, that could have been us at any given moment, at any given time. We could have been Trayvon Martin. We could have been Oscar Grant by the way that we look. Nobody knows that I'm a UC Merced student athlete, a major in international relations, a minor in business management. Nobody sees that. And that's what we need to fix. The perception of us being, you know, a threat in the public eye when people see us in a hoodie, not knowing, you know, the life that we could have in the future. So that's what I wanted to, you know, start off. This isn't a part of my suit, so
I know a lot of people are like, why is he wearing that hoodie? But this is not for us. This is just a demonstration to relate to Trayvon Martin. A lot of people are talking about the mass incarceration that's going on within the black males. That's a big problem that needs to be addressed. I actually have a statistic here that shows the amount of black men that were in jail and the amount of black men enrolled in post-secondary education. And in 2001, there were 842,000 black men in prison, and there were 712,724 enrolled in post-secondary education. It didn't start. There was more black men incarcerated than there were enrolled in education. And to me, that needs to change. We can't have more of our people in prison than in education. So a part of what I was doing this summer, and I want to just give you guys a heads up, I was in China along with my dad, who's a moderator, my mom, who is a professor. Both of them were teaching doctoral programs in China, and I got a chance to accompany them while they were in China. I got a chance to coach a basketball youth international sports camp, and I got a chance to actually learn the Chinese language. And I'll say a little Chinese, which means I'm an American. And when I was out there, I was shocked by the amount of people that would come up to me and say, Megoren, which means American. They didn't see black, they didn't see, you know, anything else. They saw me as an American, which in this country, the Supreme Court ruled that I was three-fifths of a man. So that just gives you a sense right there of what's going on internationally, how people look at it, so, as opposed to our own people here, which impacted me greatly. So while we were in China, this is actually why the forum, you know, started, because we got a chance to see the ruling on CNN about Trayvon Martin's case. And what shocked me was the fact that the white juror said, you know, we thought what they did was the right thing, to kill Trayvon Martin. And that, to me, is something of a racial hierarchy in our caste system of people, you know, not seeing that we are even worthy of living. Mm-hmm. Like, that's what needs to be addressed. And I just want to thank the Blue Lab members for inviting me onto this panel to, you know, talk about these issues and address these issues for what they are. And we need to change that. And that's all I have to say.
And last but not least, Adrian Steve.
Hello, everyone. Sorry, I'm a little stuffy, but interesting story. Actually, my name is Adrian Speed. I went to Arizona State University. It's a little different than California. And one of my experiences that I wanted to go over actually happened when I was walking back home from a track practice one day. Where I lived, there was a building just on the corner, basically. All I had to do was turn the corner to walk in and go back to my little dorm room apartment area place. And basically, there was two white cops talking to a Hispanic man. No earthly idea I was anywhere around. I was actually in all of my track and field clothes. Had a backpack on. Just came from track practice and we had to go to study hall after. So it was my freshman year of college, about 4 years ago. And I was just walking back, and out of nowhere, they just turned around, completely stopped talking to him, and ran up to me, asking me all these questions about where have I been, there was a shooting around the area. The description of the shooter was a tall black man. And like, just me. And so they actually held me there for about 20 minutes to just go over a bunch of different questions. A series of people just walking by, back and forth, and it was just pretty like, well, what do I do? Like, my mom's not here, my dad's not here, no one's here. Like, none of my friends are here. I was just after practice. And with me, that was like, what, one of my first of four pretty interesting experiences at ASU. And it's just interesting to me because there's not really too much you can do except for take the ticket and then go handle the problem after that. That one I actually didn't get a ticket. The next one, there was another experience in an elevator. There was a red cup full of alcohol. I think I actually left my building. So you know, I lived in a party building, so there was a lot of parties going on a lot. But coming back in, it was like 3:30 in the morning. And I was going up. I just pressed the elevator to go back to floor 13. The elevator actually stopped on floor 6. There was me and my roommate and his friend in there. And it just opens up, and there's just a cop. Like, I need you three to step out. We're like, well, for what? And like, he's like, well, that red cup right there is full of beer. I'm like, okay, like, sorry, like, that, you're just coming up. We step out, there's like a line of just about 6 or 7 students. There are some other race students in there, but what, 3 out of the 6 were already African American. We just added 3 more to the list. And I got MIC that night from binary consumption, and I hadn't even trade. So it was just pretty interesting to me that this was just kind of, it just happened.
And Adrian, you know, the reality, and we are going to tie this off right about on time. I'm going to ask for one little change where I'll talk to you about it in just 1 second. In light of our kids, John said it to start this, we get touched by the criminal justice system in ways that affect us for our entire lives on humbug stuff. Dave Chappelle used to have, no, it wasn't Dave Chappelle, it was the book, it was Boondocks. What was it, Chappelle? It was Chappelle, Keeping It Real Going Wrong, right? Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. We get into stuff that should be relatively minor stuff, and it winds up changing the trajectory of our entire lives. We have to stop that, and we have to account for it. Mayor Harris, Judge Ransom, and others talked about accountability. We have to embrace accountability. We can't run from it. All right, I want to cut.
Can I make one short
comment? Of course, Judge.
I said we need to go to school, but something else is drastically needed. We have to make sure our teachers are teaching.
Yeah.
And if they're not teaching, they got to do something else.
Well,
hold them accountable.
On that note, I'm going to ask Rory, we were going to do the card process, Rory. I want to open this up instead and invite people. If we can get this room for 15 more minutes, I want to ask the people who really have questions that they'd like to address to this panel to come up front and ask their question. We've gone around and around as to the best way to give people a chance to do that. If we have a live mic that they can easily access. The only thing I will ask of those of you who are asking questions is you keep them very short and that you're very concise and that you actually ask a question rather than make a statement.
At 12, because he felt a level of helplessness. His dad just went to prison almost 2 years to the date that he committed suicide. And I just want to know, is there something we can do about the helplessness, about the wars, the fathers missing?
If I may, and let me tell you, on a personal level, I'm glad you're here and sharing this perspective with us. I'm sorry for your loss, and I mean that from my heart. Judge Ransom has dealt with so many issues that have come before him in his courtroom, and he's been a leader in our community. Judge Ransom, part of the reason this panel came together is because of the passion expressed by this mother over what's happening to our sons, our grandsons, our nephews, our brothers. Could you share with us some of your thoughts?
We as a community, let me think back to something with Ellie said. When I was young, no matter what you did, by the time you got home, everybody knew about it. We as a community have got to start being isolationists. We got to care about each other. We can't have the attitude where he said, well, he or she makes me look bad. We have all got to be concerned. I said, the most important thing you can give an individual is love and hope. Love and hope, and it's a freebie. We've got to let you know that there are agencies out there that will help you. Let me just do a quick one. There's a new scholarship that's put out by a young black guy at the Drexel Institution. I want everybody to know about it. Called MySchollie.com, MYSCHOLLY.com. Gives a whole list of scholarships. We have to take interest in each other and not just stand off to the side and say, better them than not me.
I have to tell you, though, I see this often with young men, particularly in the very critical stages growing up without a dad. And it's hurtful to them. You know, I've been collecting data for the last 5 years on children, the psychological aspect of children whose parents have been killed by the police. And there's nothing more painful for those children when they don't have their dad. It's even worse when the dad is in prison, mm-hmm. which we see often. And there's no substitute for that. So therefore, the community itself has to have ways to come together and provide that father figure. Because without it, and you only have the streets, the kid is going to be lost. And I've had many situations like that where I've seen kids who have died, been
committed suicide as well. When there's no dad, and maybe three or four generations of dads who've been in prisons and have to take a family. So I feel the pain that you have. But we as a community has to band together in some way to provide that father figure for that, for those.
I want to hear from Mayor Harris, but also we've got the two gentlemen who've been very patiently quiet. Jamal Miller is the most recent appointee of this governor's administration, particularly in health care, in the mental health areas. I want to hear his perspective. You've got the people here who can make a difference in terms of policy. And so I'd like Mayor Harris to be ready. I saw he queued his mic up, and also Jamal Miller. If you'd speak for a minute on this, I'd appreciate it. Mayor Harris?
Yeah, my real quick, which is there are organizations like Gina Jackson, East Oakland Youth Development Center. There are Boys and Girls Clubs in Oakland. There are Little League programs. There are football programs. And you got to take advantage of those. Obviously, that's not enough, because they exist. And many parents take advantage of those. But if a child misses his or her father, and they can't find it in church, and they can't find it in a neighbor, I don't know how you deal with that tragic reality of a father going to jail or dying on the street. Only thing I can suggest is we got to stop fathers going to jail and fathers stop dying on the street.
I think one of the critical things that we need to do in our community is destigmatize mental health illness. But she struck a chord when she made the statement about her son. One of the things I want you guys to do when we all leave here, is Google what's called ACE. It's an acronym for Adverse Childhood Experiences. And this is a very real issue that is perplexing our community. And adverse childhood experiences are exactly that. Now, there are actually surveys and research that has been done to where if your ACE score, based on how high it is, is positively correlated with other chronic medical diseases and conditions that you ultimately would have to deal with later on in life. But when I think about your son, being 12 years old and feeling that his only option, an alternative, was committing suicide, I think, you know, where was his exposure or experience with a positive male role model in his life to that he could speak with? Was there a counselor at school? When you think about the defunding or the a lot of social services in our community and community-based organizations that are not having the necessary funding to provide services, to provide mental health support for children like your son, that's a very real issue. But look up ACE, mental health illness. We need to destigmatize that. So this is a whole other panel discussion. Let's talk about that later with respect to health care, comorbidities associated with mental health. But that's just my comment.
Mr. Miller, now that gives me a chance to let all of you know, this is an electronic age. We're going to have a site that we're going to give you the information for. There have been cards handed out to you. On those cards are barcodes. If you have a barcode reader, a scanner, a function on your phone, if not, you can download the free app, load it on your phone. You will be able to be directed to a site that's going to have all this data, everything that we use, articles from John Burris, an article that I wrote, a document that Mr. Miller was just referring to. Everything that we're discussing today will be available to you on that site, and we'll tell you how to access that. Sir?
Hello.
Hello.
My name is Kevin Davey. I'm a Sac State grad student. And I'm from Richmond, California, where John Burris put money in my pocket for all the Chevron and oil spills.
Not yet. It will happen, but not yet.
My question was profiling that relates to stereotypes. You know, stereotypes are the reason why we get profiled. Now, what ways can we curtail these stereotypes in the media or at home, so you don't have to, the police don't have to fear us automatically. Also, we don't have to fear each other as black men.
It's a great question. Mr. Jackson, if you would tell us, if I'm a young person, you knew I was coming.
It's really hard because it's not, unfortunately, that's not something that's always out of control. I don't know if Eric and Martin remember this, but there was a long time ago when I was just on a family trip with the Harris family up in Lake Tahoe. And, anyone who knows my uncle Mark and my dad, you know, we were family ever, you know, they wouldn't allow us to look like that. Because I think that they didn't want us to have to deal with that kind of prejudice. Well, you know, flash forward to when we're in Lake Tahoe, you know, which is a, you know, there's not too many African Americans that, you know, that you'll really find up there. You know, we're driving around, or not even driving, I think we were walking back to the place that we were staying, and a, I don't know if he was just a little security guy for the property or whatever, but, you know, ran over and said, oh, no, the renter's side is over on the other side, you guys. The renter's side is over on the other side, and open mark, you know, he didn't go off on the dude, like, maybe I would have, but he said, no, we own this, like, we're owners here, so no, we're going to just keep walking. And, you know, it's just small things like that, that although it's unfortunate, and although, you know, they, you know, they being, you know, the generation before us has done their best to try and prepare us and give us, being young African-American males, anything that we can do to make that easier on us, it's ultimately, it's unfortunate, but it's out of our control.
And one thing that Mayor Harris talked about, I'll go to you next, Jed, is conformity. I said that when I talked to Asa said, I don't want to conform to someone else's ideal. And Ellie said, well, you're conforming to somebody's ideal. I mean, even if it's a thug ideal, you're conforming to that if you go that direction. I will tell you, the frustration of the young man from Richmond, you really raise a good point, because my son, Martin, who you all see before you, I'll just put his business on the street like I tend to do in my classes, since he's a student in the same school I teach at. My colleague, who is a wonderful member of our faculty and has become his chief advocate, came to me when he was on campus 2 weeks and said, Professor Harris, I have something I need to share with you. I said, go ahead, tell me what you're thinking. She said, I think your son is a gang member. This is a Caucasian woman from the Central Valley who's on the faculty. I said, excuse me, but how do you come to that? First of all, how would I miss that? But anyway. I said, how do you come to that conclusion? She said, by how he looks. By the flip-flops, the saggy shorts, the white tees. She went through the whole thing. And she literally, this is S.A. Davis, my dear colleague, said he must be a gangster. And it took me a year before I even shared with him this story. Because he, it turned out, became very close to her. I didn't want to mess up what could be a potential positive look. I had to tell her, no, he's not a gangster. And the point is, you need to check yourself in terms of how you could draw that conclusion on the basis of appearance before you even know this kid, and feel comfortable enough to come and share that with me. I was upset on several levels. But this issue that Asa talks about, it doesn't get better. You can look as clean as the counselor who's about to speak and still be confronted with these issues that we talk about. It's a very frustrating set of circumstances. Check.
Yep. I want to say the reality is that many of us in this room contributed to the environment under which Trayvon and Oscar were shot. And the reality is that the many things that we've been talking about this afternoon, about the stereotypes and the perceptions and about the interactions that we have as African Americans in this community, we've contributed to. We sit here day after day watching reality television shows that portray us as buffoons and idiots. And we laugh and we think it's funny because we have our education, because we're smart, and because we don't act like that. But the rest of society does not think of us like that, of like us like we are. They think of us like that. And that's what our children look to. I was in D.C., and it was a panel of young African-American professionals. And they talked about their aspirations and how they had achieved and what they were looking at. You know what they talked about? The Cosby Show. And how they wanted to have the relationship and the family situation like they saw on the Cosby Show. What TV shows do we have today that are the Cosby Show? We have players and pimps talking about how they're having sex with multiple women, and those are the African American males who we idealize in our society. And so when you wonder why it's easy for a police officer to step up and shoot an African American male, it's because the environment that we've created. It's the spirit under which we've allowed for
for these individuals to interact with us. We have to control our story. We have to tell a better story about who we really are as African-American men. Chris Johnson, can you stand up, please? Because I want to tell a real story about what's going on in Sacramento. Yeah. This is a hero in Sacramento right now. Chris Johnson was profiled yesterday on ABC on Shark Tank. We had a huge party to celebrate this black man's success. These are the stories that we have to fight to tell. These are the stories of individuals that we have to have on our television programs for our children to look at and to aspire to and to believe in. Because if we don't put him up on the pedestal, all we're going to put on pedestals are drug dealers and pimps. And if that's really what you want in your community, if you just want to continue with the same old rhetoric and the same old stories, then that's what you're going to get. So you, as an individual, have to make conscious decisions about what you're purchasing and what you're viewing. And if you're mad about what happened with Trayvon, go back in your DVR and see what you have in there.
It's really, it's the young people that are seeing this and doing it. And it allows for the stereotypic notions that allow the police to make judgments about you based upon it. But it's really the kids you have to deal with. They're the ones that are seeing it and getting caught up in it. So the question, how do you stop that? I mean, do you want to go tell Kyle Perry that you can't produce certain content?
Absolutely.
Had some great experiences at the Democratic National Committee, and Congresswoman Barbara Lee's office. I had great experiences there, but I didn't feel like I was reaching the individuals and the communities that I was trying to reach directly. And for me, that means reaching out to the inner cities and African-American communities. An organization that my dad was referring to, I felt like I needed to start because I wasn't able to reach those communities. This organization is called Tomorrow's Today. The organization has a focus on mentoring young athletes, high school level athletes right now, and we are hoping to branch out to others. We really think, and like a lot of us were talking about earlier, with all the problems that we have with having proper mentors and having fathers around and giving good advice to young people, my brother, the two gentlemen behind me, we are really trying to make a direct impact with people and groups that we care about by helping them out in any way, not just educationally, but speaking to them about social issues, understanding how they need to act in certain environments, etc.
Asa?
I wanted to say this, actually, when you were asking your question earlier, concerning your son, and I really wanted to applaud Eric for what he's doing, because as a young African American man, it's sometimes hard to take direct, I don't want to say orders, but it's sometimes hard to take that influence from parental figures. Just, you know, as a young just man, period, it's hard. And organizations like what Eric is doing, that's personally, for someone who was a 12-year-old African-American male, that's where we need to do it. Have peer mentoring stuff. Have people who, you know, are still, you know, 20s, 80s, whatever it is, talking to the younger kids about, look, I've been exactly where you are, and it was really not that long ago, and you can look to me and look at me, and you can make it. You're not, it's not hopeless. I'm not saying it's easy, but you can make it, and we can make it, and we have made it. And so I really wanted to applaud Eric for what he's doing, because that's something that I, you know, really feel and really feel strongly about.
Thank you, Judge Ransom.
Here's reality.
Here, three more questions.
Here's reality. Let's say you're the type of moans and groans, but you don't vote. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? Mm-hmm. They don't let you moan and groan. You got to get out there and vote, and get other people to vote, or else you don't matter.
Sir.
And just to segue with that, Honorable Ransom, I'll say this. You know, just because you don't take an interest in politics doesn't mean that politics won't take an interest in you.
Hello.
My name is Conrad Crump, Mr. Harris,
good to see
Mr. Harris,
you,
Mr. Harris, all of the honorables. I just want to be real concise and let you know I'm delighted to be here. I'm from Sacramento, California. I'm privileged enough to work here at the California State Capitol for an assembly member, Honorable Assembly Member Jose Medina. With that, I'm also privileged enough to work for the California Capitol State Black Staff Association. Mm-hmm. With that being said, my question is this. For an individual who's privileged enough to be in both worlds, much like probably many of you who, as coming up as a young professional, you know, growing up and just navigating through life, you know, with your foot in both worlds, one foot in a legislative professional arena, one foot in a, you know, neighborhood that is outright just, you know, downtrodden, and you're, you know, navigating between both of these worlds, what are ways in which I, myself, or individuals who are much like me, can contribute and also reach and connect the individuals when we have forums like this? Because I've invited folks, I put folks up on Facebook, I've talked to so many people about this event, but I don't know what it is. What can I do to actually captivate them, to get them to want to be in on conversations like this so we can gather more people in on the conversation and move forward?
I don't know about the rest of these folks, but if Mr. Crump talks to them, he's pretty doggone persuasive. I'm coming wherever you tell me to come. Let me ask Mr. Cole. We haven't heard from Attorney Cole in quite some time. I'd like to hear from him on this, and then I'm going to ask Adrian Speed as well, if we can. Jim Cole.
We've had some wonderful suggestions as to how to address the problem. I am proud, as I said before, that we in the Boule, under the leadership of Grand Cy Payne, are addressing many of these problems, particularly through the Commission on Young Black Males that he's appointed. They're doing research, documenting programs that work, that we can share with the broader community as to how to address these concerns. It is my intention, certainly as Grand Cy Archon succeeding our current Grand Cy Archon, to continue these programs and to expand them so that we can provide even more leadership in addressing these concerns. One of the things that I speak of frequently when I speak with young black males is the reality that they are black, will always be black, and to learn how to deal with being black. And that is a lesson that we've all touched on in terms of Mayor Harris talked about the police, what happens when you stop by the police. Our young males need to understand how important it is to not overreact and in terms of what to do and what not to do. This has long been a concern of Sigma Chi Phi fraternity and will be a continuing concern, particularly for the next 2 years.
Well, my name is DeMarcus Ryan, and I'm somebody from the market. And I have just had a simple question. Well, I think it's simple, but what strategies and ideas do you guys all have that will help empower young African American women in such a way that it might inspire them to develop, you know, the desire to arise to a higher level of thinking? Yeah. That they might look at themselves as a king instead of a loser, or you are a leader instead of a chump, you know, right.
If I may, and I want to hear from Mr. Harris first, he grabbed his mic, but I want, again, two of the youngest archons among us to talk about that. I want Jamal and Chet, we've already heard from you guys. No, I want you first, Ali, and then I'd like them, please, Mr. Harris.
Okay, first thing, we choose our own role model, whether it's on the street. There are plenty of positive role models out here. I'm not that high on Obama either, but he's the president. So you can't get much better than that. Mm-hmm. You may be able to do more than he's doing, but he certainly has achieved a great office and certainly a unique situation. You know, we have to at least look at ourselves in terms of my role model wasn't necessarily my father, even though he tried me, he imposed his will, but I didn't want it. He wanted me to open a funeral home. That wasn't all my business, thank you. But, you know, and I didn't know any lawyers when I was growing up. The only lawyer I knew was Lionel Wilson, who I succeeded as mayor of Oakland. And that was because when I was in the sixth grade, I had a little white girl in the mouth, and I had to get a lawyer. So, I mean, sometimes by accident, did you find a John Burris representing you? Or did you find a minister who you say, I'd like to be like him? That's a person. You look for role models around you. You look for a father figure. It may not be your father figure, it may be your friend's father. They're all around us. The question is, who do we choose?
Excellent. Chet?
Quickly, I'm going to say, as on the executive board for the Unblack Men. And what we say is, what you see is what you'll be. And I think, again, it goes back to my earlier point about telling the right stories and putting the images in front of kids. If you tell kids, guys like Jackie Robinson were great baseball players, but then also contributed and created a black bank, to start getting them to think outside the box, to start telling them to be owners of basketball teams instead of players of basketball teams, we'd be a lot further along our community.
Beautiful point. Mr. Mill, just briefly, I'll give you, I've learned in a professional setting this. We have our own development plans. I'll leave you with the three E's, brother. And the three E's are exposure, experience, and education. When I look at, you know, my advancement professionally, when I look at those who inspire me to go into healthcare, which I had a black male pediatrician growing up, Dr. Vernon Malton, who inspired me to go into healthcare in the first place, had the privilege of getting an education at Columbia University with the USC, and had the opportunity to be a hospital administration resident in a major hospital system here in Sacramento. So if you link those three E's, education, exposure, and experience, that makes the difference at the end of the day. And there have been so many of the archons in Gamma Epsilon Boule. I grew up, didn't even know Boule existed, but they made an impact in my life
And it all had to do in some way, shape, or form with those three E's. So I can give that to you to take away and inspire other youngsters with what I call the three E's. And I'm Corwin, that's where the three E's come from.
Thank you. Please, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Destiny Robbins, and I'm very happy to be here right now because this subject is something that's very passionate to me. Now, to follow up on the three E's, I'm currently a Master's of Social Work student at USC. I graduated at the top of my class through UOP, but I'm still, like many of my other peers, floating to figure out what venue to work through to get this mission accomplished. And so I was just trying to find out. I've had a lot of great exposure. I've had a lot of great, you know, different connects that I've made, but I'm still drifting. I started out wanting to be an actress. Now I'm going to be an advocate. That was my mom actually who spoke about my brother who committed suicide. So I just wanted to hear for the young professionals that are up and coming, that are looking to place themselves, what do you advise for them, you know, other than mentors?
If I may, John Streeter has two very successful daughters and has given his time and energy on a variety of different fronts to mentor. I'd like him to speak a little bit about the response to the question. What do you tell young people who are trying to find their way at this point in time?
Well, there's no magic formula, you know, I think, as a parent, other than, you know, the basic values of working hard and the importance of achievement in education. Somehow, we need to find a way to get our children understand that it is through achievement in education that they will go to the next level and the level above that. And it's not you can't see the end game when you're doing it. But if we can praise them for every success they have, if we can put in front of them the value of getting A's, of carrying books around, and of reading, these are really basic things. But it starts with us as parents in making them feel good about these things. And I can tell by your presence and the way you carry yourself that your mother did that with you. And it saddens me tremendously that she's obviously done that with you. And we have this great loss in the room, and that is your brother who lost his life at 12.
Mr. Harris?
Several things. Internships are wonderful. If you can't get a job, get an internship with somebody you admire or an organization you believe is actually doing something. Secondly, look at things like the fellowship programs at the Capitol. There's the Assembly of the Senate and the Executive Fellowship Program.
And the chief clerks.
They're making these kinds of opportunities. And if you find somebody you really admire, get to know them. You'd be surprised how people take an interest in you if you take an interest in them. You know, when Mark Harris from law school, he said, when I graduated from law school, he said, I want a job. I said, well, come on. The after graduation is in my office. I should have closed the door.
This
is what I tell people from the bench. You got to find something that you have a passion for.
Yeah.
A lot of times people say, I want to do this because you make a lot of money. I know people who make a lot of money, very happy. I know people who make almost nothing, happiest souls on earth. You got to find something you have a passion for. And just go for it. And it doesn't matter how extreme it is. You may say, I want to be a brain surgeon. I firmly believe, and I tell people from the bench, most of the world is negative. Not only do they not want to do anything, but they want to slow you down. So don't tell them what you want to do.
Right.
Just go out and do it.
I knew she would do it. And if I may, it's a perfect segue to two more quick ones. Eric wanted to say something, but I want to call. Asa is the son of two Johns Hopkins trained doctors. Let me just put his stuff out there on Front Street. This young man's grandfather was in the boule, his father is in the boule, he's in the audience. And we gave him a hard time about this dream he had to be this NFL player. I'm gonna tell you straight up, it wasn't valued. Being a professional athlete in our circle wasn't necessarily highly valued. And to his credit, he didn't care. It's what you said, Judge. He said, I'm gonna do me. And he's done him all the way to a Super Bowl ring in a meeting with President Obama. Mr. Jackson.
It's hard to do something that you're not passionate about. That's one thing that I learned. You know, just like my uncle said, you know, growing up in a family where, you know, I was fortunate enough to have so many professionals around me, and getting to see, you know, getting exposed to so much of that stuff, for me, it made success not in It wasn't an option, it was expected of me. But success and, you know, following in their footsteps are two totally different things, at least to me. I had to find for me what I loved and what I could put my 180% focus into. And to be successful, ultimately, anything, you have to be able to do that. That's the one thing that I've learned. You know, it takes, you know, everyone wants to play in the NFL and, you know, make millions of dollars, but not too many people want to wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday and go out and get that work in.
That's right.
And if anyone who knows me knows I'm not a morning person at all. But the passion that I have for the game that I play, it makes that easy. It makes it second nature. It makes it, you know, that's just what I do. And I'm really thankful to, you know, my dad and the other people that have supported me through this whole thing, because, you know, first and foremost, I couldn't have done it all the way without them and that support. But at the same time, it falls a lot on you to find something that you're truly passionate about, because that's the only way you're gonna give it everything that you have. And you may not find it this early. It may come, you know, years down the line, but something that you're truly passionate about, is that's the way to go.
Last reaction, Mr. Harris.
Like I said earlier, I've been really fortunate to have some great mentors in my life. My dad being one of the best mentors that I could have, asked me when I was a really young person, straight up, what are you passionate about? And I'm like, I don't know what I want to do. I don't know if I want to go to grad school. I said, what are you passionate about? I said, I'm passionate about helping people, public service, doing what I can to help my community. So as the saying goes around my school, the University of Oregon, just do it. Like Nike, just do it. And I was inspired by him, inspired by my grandparents, to just do what you're passionate about. Find other people who are doing what you want to do, and go do it. Thank you. Chris.
Well said, Eric. I wanted to start off by thanking the whole panel for coming out today. It's a great honor to have all you guys, and a lot of you, I look up to you, a lot of you, and you know, it's an honor. So, I was watching CNN about 6 weeks ago, and I found this really awful statistic. Don Lemon was talking about it, and it has relevance to this. And he said the biggest killer of young men, African American men, 15 to 24, is not illness. It's not anything you would think about. It's other young African American men. And it's really unfortunate to think about that. You know, we talk about our police officers and how it's really unfair, you know, how a lot of them cast aspersions among young African American men. But what should we really be afraid of? You know, and I wanted to see all your takes on that, because it's tough. You know, we have so many enemies, and we don't know which one is the real one. So,
Mr. Is that you grab for the mic, Mayor Harris?
Yeah,
please.
You know, John said we have 130 homicides in the city of Oakland. When I became mayor, it was 175, and John said about 95% of them were black. And I would go out to the community, and they would complain about the murder rate. I'd go up in the Oakland Hill, and a lot of people who were wealthy and well-to-do. And I said, look, if you're Oakland, the safe city of America, if you like. And the bottom line is, you've got to be afraid of people who look like you. You really got to start saying, what do we do internally? How do we begin to shape value? How do we begin to mentor? All these kind of things can only be done by people who actually live in the community. Look at your race. It has to do with your neighborhood and your being involved. And when we don't fear each other, we're not scared of each other, everything's going to get better.
Here we are, our friend from South, from Stockton, California.
Hopefully after I make these comments, I'll still be your friend. As well as fellow Archon.
Yeah.
My name is irrelevant, where I come from is irrelevant. But I stand here before you to honor my mother and father, so all the days of my life will be long. Question is simply this. When are we going to get a hunger and thirst again as a people for the word of God to change our life and change our path as African Americans?
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. I know Mayor Harris has something to say about that, among others. I am unashamed
unashamed in my pursuit of expressing my faith, even at the University of California, which is supposed to be a separation of church and state. So some of us have varied from this path. We did receive a challenge here in Sacramento recently from someone who challenged the clergy to be more of a participant in some of these things we're talking about, including not marrying couples who have not gone through a certain counseling process, not acknowledging and baptizing children who were born of unwed parents. I mean, there's a whole lot we could talk about in terms of a potential role for the church and the clergy. This isn't the time or place, but I think it's an excellent point to make. Mayor Harris.
I think regardless of your faith, the one thing that seems to be common in all religions is the idea of treating people the way you want to be treated, and the word respect. But since I'm a Christian, as Mark indicated, there's a whole lot of people who call themselves Christians who, if Christianity was a crime, they'd never be convicted. Christians have got to start acting like Christians, right? Ministers have got to start ministering. You know, when you got ministers who are only in church on Sunday, I don't have any respect for them. I don't care if they got a collar off. I don't care if they got robes on. They're just another person. Unless they earn the respect of their job, their office, wherever you are, by your conduct, by your involvement, no one's going to respect you if you brought that up to church. The church has got to be a relevant institution. It's got to be open 7 days a week. When kids get out of school, they're not safe. They ought to be able to go to church. On Saturday, church ought to be open, not just on Sunday. So what you said is very important, but it's only going to be important when churches start acting like churches.
Thank you. That's a fitting place for us to end. Let's give this panel a round of applause.